Yo, what up, fam? I decided to come back to the block to put y'all up on some more game. And this time, my mans, Jalen, pulled up. For a young bull, he's quite brilliant. An A&T graduate. That's North Carolina A&T State University, for those who ain't hip to that. Anyway, I think you're going to enjoy the cipher. But hold up, though. Do me a favor. Hit that subscribe button. YouTube is giving me no love until I get at least 1,000 subscribers. And since I just got started, I only got 50 and I need a whole stack. So help a brother out. Anyway, today we're gonna talk about one of the most fundamental impacts or outcomes of blockchain technology, decentralization. For some, this is cutting out the middleman. For others, it's getting one step closer to the plug. Either way, prepare to get a little bit more hip to this blockchain hustle. Rock with me.
So we know we're here today to talk about disintermediation. But it'll probably be helpful for the audience if we first define what intermediation is before we start talking about disintermediation. So, Jalen, why don't you give us, start with the layman's definition, of mm-hmm. intermediation, and then let's go to like an official definition after that.
Definitely. So, first of all, like intermediation is just a fancy word for like middleman services, right? So, if somebody's an intermediary, that all that means is they stand between two other people or two other parties, who are trying to do some type of transaction, and they help make sure that that transaction goes smoothly. So that's like, the basic layman definition of it. But the actual financial definition of it is a financial intermediary is an entity that acts as a middleman between two parties in a financial transaction, such as a commercial bank, an investment bank, mutual fund, or pension fund. Financial intermediaries offer a number of benefits to average customers or consumers, including safety, liquidity, and economies of scale. So, yeah.
Yeah. I think everybody understands like what a middleman is, right? Yeah. Sometimes middlemen are useful. Sometimes middlemen, like they want you to think that they're useful, but right. really, they're just there for various reasons and they're able to like tax you like that. Like that troll under the bridge that makes you pay a tax before you cross the bridge. But let's get into this like middleman tax, right? Like, yeah. Give us some examples like in everyday life, right? How like a middleman will basically tax you for their services.
Definitely. So like to go back to sort of this intermediary definition, I think the easiest example is to always point to like a commercial bank. I think the mm-hmm. commercial bank is like the biggest middleman that we sort of have in our society, if you will. And so, when you think about sort of the implications or the taxes that come with that, I mean, they're the obvious ones, right? Like the actual taxes and fees or better yet, the fees for using their service. But then there are the ones that are more implicit, right? So like, then you've got the fact that, they're earning money on top of your money and basically risking your funds to do it, then... Then there's like what I'm now calling sort of like the data tax, right? It's a non-financial tax, but it basically means that, they get to take all of your data and then not only expose it to, potential risk, but also like sell it off to other people who are going to use it against you, in the future, ultimately to get more money out of you, right? So that's why I look at that like as a tax in itself.
On that point, though, that takes me back to my Electo days, how like, the banks would basically sell your financial data to the electric company in your area or the phone company in your area. And a lot of people don't realize this, but like sometimes if you, let's just say you paid your phone bill late or something like that, your Visa credit card interest rate would go up, even though you might've paid that one time all the time. But the fact that you pay, some other thing late and the bank knows that and they sold that data, to the credit card company, the credit card's like, oh, I can use this to make more money off this person through higher interest rates. Like the whole thing is like incestuous, but yeah.
For real. And I'll say this, man, like you know, I don't, while I'm clearly a champion of a disintermediated financial system, honestly, I'm a champion of like the disintermediation of everything. But that to me, that doesn't mean that there is no use for a middleman, right? Or at least some sort of like quasi middleman service, right?
Of course, yeah.
I think the problem that we have happened to sort of run into at this particular time in history is what happens when middlemen become too big and they become overly centralized, right? Because then there's a social tax on top of that, which effectively is now, as we see, I think even the general American who probably doesn't have, you know, a lot of awareness of lobbying and you know, sort of what goes on behind the political scenes will still be able to tell you that big money influences politics, right?
Oh, yeah.
Which then, of course, influences all other aspects of society. And it's like, again, it's not that a middleman in and of itself, you know, by definition does that, but it's that once a middleman becomes like the middleman for everybody, right, within a given community, they now have like, they have everybody's purse strings.
They got a monopoly. I mean, what you're going into is like the whole thing about market power and market dominance, right? And like, you know, to take it to the streets, like big bank take little bank, right? Like it don't matter what, you know, what you want or what you feel, right? As long as there's that market power, like they're gonna bully their way through whatever. And that's just how it is. There's a couple other examples that people might be familiar with in terms of like an intermediary, right? And again, it's not that intermediaries are all bad. It's just that when they do achieve market dominance and power, they're able to extract more and more tax. But if you think about it, what does Airbnb do? There are people who own properties, right? And there are people who want to visit somewhere and stay at a nice property. And these people want to do commerce with one another. So if you're staying in California and I'm in DC, and I come to Cali and I want to rent your place and you want to rent me your place, you know, we should be able to do that. Right now, Airbnb facilitates that, but Airbnb is going to charge you money. And that is going to impact what you charge me, right? Which means I'm going to pay more. They're basically extracting a tax. Now, Airbnb does not own any property. They facilitate, right? They're a facilitator. And so like, what is the appropriate fee for facilitating that transaction? The same thing with Uber. Right. You know, if you're driving a car and you want to give people rides and I happen to be somewhere in the city and it's raining and I want to ride. Right. Like we, you know, would like to be able to exchange. Right. I'd like to be able to purchase the services that you're offering at that time. And Uber facilitates that. Before Uber, like we were just stuck with the taxi, you know, cabs or whatever. Uber facilitates that. So then the question becomes like, well, how much value is it right for Uber to extract from that transaction? Like, what is the appropriate compensation for them facilitating that? And you know, we can get into that. But I think that kind of covers, you know, sort of what intermediation is, right? Like Uber is an intermediary, Airbnb is an intermediary, and the banks are intermediaries as well, right? As well as the credit card companies. And speaking of credit card companies, right? I think a lot of people, you know, when you swipe your Visa card or your MasterCard, for you, you're just making a payment. But on the merchant side, the merchant's paying 30 cents plus 30% of whatever the transaction is, right? And I think American Express charges even more. So what happens is that the merchant, they actually increase their prices for what you pay as a consumer to compensate for the fees that they have to pay for credit cards. And if anybody's gone to like a local deli, you know what I mean? They're like, no credit card transactions under $5. That's because they're paying that tax. Like they're not going to pay like that high tax on like, you know, some $1 transaction. So you got to keep that in mind. You know, I think the most notorious sort of like, you know, tax that the middleman, you know, charges is, and it was a big deal a while back, but like them overdraft fees, you hear people like paying like, you know, $500 in overdraft fees because of like, you know, one bounce check at Domino's Pizza or something like that. You know what I'm saying? It's crazy.
Right.
But anyway, let's move on. So we've defined intermediation. Talk to us about disintermediation.
Right. So disintermediation, I mean, obviously, right, it's kind of like the opposite of, which basically is a system wherein, you know, two people could transact, right, or two parties could transact without any sort of like middle person or middle party in between to act again as that middleman. And so like, I think one of the more prevalent sort of, I guess, examples of a disintermediated system or just disintermediated technologies or like peer-to-peer systems, right? You've heard of like peer-to-peer lending platforms. You've now got these peer-to-peer closed-in payment networks, right? Like these different mechanisms and platforms that allow us to now do these same transactions that we've been doing before, but without having to have, you know, a Bank of America in between, or you know, in the case of, you know, Airbnb, you know, not having to have a centralized group like that in between. So that's kind of the definition of disintermediation or disintermediated system.
So, but yeah, basically cutting out the middleman. It's funny because exactly. You mentioned a few of these things. Many people aren't aware yet. There are significant blockchain projects, you know, in development right now to basically create the blockchain-based Airbnb with no intermediary, or the blockchain-based Uber with no intermediary. And again, this, I'm going to take it back to like why intermediaries aren't bad completely, right? It's like, you know, you would like to know that somebody's looking out for your security, right? That somebody has vetted, you know, they vetted, you know, the person who you're about to hop in their car and drive off with, or they vetted the person who you're about to, you know, rent their place. You know, blockchain has an answer for that too. And exactly. We're not going to go deep into that in this episode, but there's these things called oracles and third-party service providers that provide data to then inform some of these transactions. You know, speaking of disintermediation, or getting back to that specifically, we're talking about cutting out the middleman, right? Yep. And so, you know, taking it to the streets a little bit, or like pop culture, right? Like this is all about like getting next to the plug, right? Like if you had like 1, 2, 3 middlemen in between you and the plug, like your tax is going to go way up. You know what I mean? And so, you know, The Wire is a popular show. So, you know, if you haven't been on the block yourself, maybe you've seen the block, you know, in The Wire. You know, there was a series of episodes where Marlo Stansfield, you know, he put Prop Joe down. Right. And Prop Joe was the middleman in between him and the Greek. And the Greek was the one bringing in, you know, like the best, I think it was Heron at the time, you know, into the city of Baltimore, whatever. But that basically, you know, is disintermediation, basically eliminated that middleman. And he got, you know, right next to the plug. You know, in corporate America, they might call that a vertical integration. I mean? That would be the corporate term for what Marlo did. You know, another example that a lot of us, you know from the movie Scarface, when Tony Montana, you know, he whacked Frank, you know, he basically killed Frank, and he started dealing directly with Sosa, right? And so what happened? He started making more money. Why? There's no middleman taking their cut, right?
Right.
And so Tony Montana is getting all the money.
I was going to say another example, I guess a cinematic example that sticks out in my mind is American Gangster, right? With Frank Lucas.
That's right.
Kind of showing how, you know, he transcended like the Italian mobsters to effectively get his own direct connection to the source of heroin. So, and I think the thing that struck me about that, and I mean, I kind of assume was, I guess, part of the point of the movie was, you know, what they show us is like once he gets next to the plug, right, now he's able to create access for a whole different sort of like group of people, right?
That's
right. And then it changes not only the dynamic of their community, but then also like, you know, creates this whole ripple effect, you know, that bleeds into the police force, that bleeds into back into the Italian mob, right? Like, so I think that's, for me, once I started to become aware of this intermediated sort of systems, like, that's where my mind started to go, is what are the possibilities if we are in fact able to effectively cut the middleman, you know, out of society, really? Like,
yeah, that Frank Lucas reference, I think that's important because there's another aspect of this, right? Middlemen don't like to be cut out. So when you cut the middleman out, they're going to push back. Now, whether that's going to start a mob war or whether it's going to start, you know, a corporate war, but like middlemen like the money that they make. And so, you know, you have to be prepared for that. And so there is quite a bit of pushback to blockchain. And when it first came out, particularly in the financial sector and DeFi was starting to loom large, the banks pushed back hard. Like there's direct quotes from Jamie Dimon, you know, saying that Bitcoin is trash. A lot of people in the financial sector who saw Bitcoin as a threat to their business, and rightfully so, They were trashing it to basically give themselves some time to figure out how to neutralize it. I'm going to go deep in that in another episode, but I think that Frank Lucas reference, I think that's a real good call. You know, from a corporate perspective, so if we take it away from the streets and cinematography or cinematic rather, you know, Apple, right? Like part of Apple's brilliance is that, you know, from the get-go, right? They disintermediated. Most computers and PCs, they had the model of, you know, they manufacture it and then they have to go to retail and then retail sells it, right? So they sell wholesale prices to the store and then the store sells retail, right? There's a margin in there between that wholesale and resale cost that the manufacturer is losing out on. Right. And so what Apple did, you know, they a long time ago, there were like specific Apple stores, not like today, but they basically cut the whole retail system out and they were basically taking all of their money. Right. Dell computers did the same thing. You know, I think they were one of the first PC manufacturers to straight to consumer, cut out all retail. You know, you could dial 1-800 whatever to buy your Dell computer. You could, you know, go to their website and buy your Dell computer, but there was no middleman extracting value from the product that they produced. I know you've got some examples. You know, why don't you go ahead with that, Jalen?
Yeah. So the example that's top of mind for me right now is really like in the podcast space, or I guess you might even say like just the digital media space, right? So like, you know, I'm a regular viewer of the Joe Budden podcast. That's like one of my favorite joints, right?
Yeah. Wait. What's up with Rory and Mal? There's like something going on.
Oh man. Oh man. First of all, I just want to say,
don't break up the group. First the fat boys break up.
Yeah. Yo, it's crazy. Like, but yeah, I don't know, man. And honestly, you know, I'm not so sure that this example that I'm about to give, right, doesn't have something to do with their beef.
Interesting.
You know, because basically, you know, if for anybody who has not been watching or I guess listening to the Joe Budden podcast, right? Like this,
you need to
number one. Yeah. And then number two, you know, this is a show basically that started, I guess, maybe 5 years ago at this point. And they started out, you know, primarily on YouTube. Like I'm setting aside the audio only folks for a second here, just for the sake of the conversation. So they started out primarily on YouTube, right? Everybody is familiar with YouTube, but YouTube is like one of the prime examples of like, I guess you would say, a digital content intermediary, right? All of us as consumers, we go on and we all make YouTube accounts, right? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, whether it's a paid account or a free account, we then use their platform to go find our different individual, you know, content sets that we like. Within YouTube is actually the one that's like, you know, organizing all the data, so to speak, and then determining, you know, on the backside,
selling the advertisements and then monetizing and paying the content creators. Yeah,
exactly. And deciding who gets what, right? So basically what we're seeing now with Patreon, right? So basically now, I guess maybe within the last 6 months, maybe less than that, the Joe Budden podcast is now added on sort of like this additional Patreon content, right? It's like the exclusive stuff. Right. Yeah. But really, I see what they're doing, which is they are trying to shift their consumer behavior to the point where they get more accustomed to patronizing them on Patreon as opposed to relying on YouTube, you know, to consume their content.
That's right.
So the way that Patreon works is, you know, as a Patreon user, instead of me just like going on and having one Patreon account that Patreon then effectively, you know, uses to divvy out to the rest of the merchants or what have you. Like I get to just become an account holder effectively of the Joe Budden podcast, right? So I'm willing to pay, you know, my five, 10, however many dollars specifically for them. And it's basically a direct transaction between us. Although of course the Patreon platform, you know, gives us the basis to do it. But nonetheless, it's not that same, like very centralized sort of like flow that YouTube uses. A lot of people see content. Yeah.
There's another, so there's the control of the money, but there's something else in that there's censorship, right? So like YouTube, and this was what sent a lot of people to Patreon in the first place. YouTube will be like, I don't like what you're saying. You know what I'm saying? Like you got some ideas and opinions that I don't appreciate. or a set of people out in the internet don't like it, even though there's plenty of people that do because they follow you and they watch you. But because there's a certain subset of people that don't like it, and I just don't want, I don't want wreck, I don't want beef, I don't want that smoke, I'm just going to deplatform you. I'm going to stop showing advertisements, you know, on your channel, and you're not going to make any money. And so these content creators were like, well, you know, you're stealing my voice. I can't, you know, I understand this is not the government. So like freedom of speech doesn't necessarily apply, but really your speech is being censored, and you're being hit in your pockets for it. And so, you know, there's a little a cartoon when I was a kid that used to come on Schoolhouse Rock, Mother Necessity, where would we be, right? Necessity is the mother of all invention. So here comes Patreon. I was like, oh, YouTube doesn't want you to get paid for your content. We got you. And there it is. And so that's a form of disintermediation, you know, as well. So, you know, you mentioned this notion of peer-to-peer, right? And I think, you know, people hear that all the time. They might not like understand, you know, what it is, but peer-to-peer is basically, you know, being able to interact with someone or interact, you know, with another entity, be it a business or an individual, without a middleman, you know, in the middle, like facilitating and or, you know, taking a cut. So, you know, speak on that, you know, like, how do you see, you know, peer-to-peer, you know, today and then moving forward?
Yeah, like, so the first thing is, you know, I kind of want to think about or talk a little bit about, like, why peer-to-peer is even possible. And I won't go into like the deep technical aspects of it, right? But just sort of at a higher level. Because it's like, as I learn about this stuff, man, and I oftentimes I'll sit back and reflect on like why were we not doing it this way to begin with? Right. That's the question that I always have. And the simple answer is like technology, but to like be a little bit more, you know, specific. It's like basically, you know, every transaction ultimately has to sort data, right? Especially in today's world, like our money is effectively just bytes of data, right?
Yep, true that.
And so, you know, we all need somebody to effectively say, okay, Walter has this many apples, Jalen has this many oranges, right? And like they've agreed that they're going to do an exchange of 1.5 apples to an orange, right? And then also verifying that, you know, Walter sent his apples, and so Jalen now also needs to send his oranges, right? And that's
what you're talking about is trust, basically. Like, how do I trust?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Exactly. Yeah. Right. Like, that's really the point here, right? I think is trust and sort of how we, not even how we define trust, but like what we put our trust in, right? Mm-hmm. So basically, it used to be size mattered, right? Like, so big brands that had these long history, you know, stories, like these were the companies that we trusted, I think, because there was this implicit notion that like, yo, they've been around forever. If they were janky, they would have been gone by now, right? Or they're
right.
You know what I'm saying? Or like their brand is too big, they can't afford to have some bullshit scandal on there.
Little did we know.
They can't, right, exactly, right? And then, you know, fast forward to now and you have Wells Fargo, you got Facebook, like you got all of the different scandals.
Yeah.
So, but because of that, going back to the good point that you made, which is necessity now being sort of the impetus for any invention, right? Like that trust has been undermined. And so now it's like, well, we can't trust like these like centralized organizations just because they're big anymore. Like they've gotten to the point where they'll just use that against us. So what can we trust? Right. And I think at this point, like we all kind of feel like at some level we can trust technology, right? To at least, you know, not have alternative motives, you know, of its own.
Specifically open source technology where we can see the code. And like, right, I don't know, true. You know, for the viewers out there, you can go to GitHub and you can look at the code, right? For Bitcoin, you can actually, you know, when we talk about Ethereum and these smart contracts, you can go look at the code. So you don't have to trust any human being. You just need to understand what the code does, and that the code will always do what it says it will do, and it can never change. And that's the beauty of the blockchain. But I'm sorry, I interrupted. Go ahead, man.
No, you were good. You're good. But basically, man, like it is the code, right? I know in sort of like the blockchain ecosystem, if you will, especially like if we're talking smart contracts here, right? Like code is law, right?
That's right.
And that's sort of like the fundamental belief. And that's, at least that's where I see peer-to-peer going, right? Where it's this implicit understanding between two or more people that code is law, right? And that we all have access or awareness of the code, at least, right? And that the code, like you said, is going to do, you know, what it says it's going to do. And I think I don't want to call it the fallout, but the consequence of that is like almost immeasurable. And the reason being, man, is because, and this might be me getting up on my soapbox a little bit or putting on my hood philosopher hat real quick, right?
Yeah.
But you know, aside from all of the taxes going away, like we were talking about earlier, or at least right. like being reduced significantly.
Absolutely.
I think there's also like a psychological effect that's going to have, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, I think through this very like centralized intermediated system that we've all been born into, I think we have like developed the psychology of like dependency, you know what I'm saying? Or the opposite of self-reliance, right? Yeah. So, which makes us, you know, and evidence of that would be, I think, why we're so susceptible to like dependency on our phones, right? Dependency, mm-hmm. you know, on drugs, quite honestly, like, because we've been sort of conditioned in a way that says like, I have to go outside of myself, right? And ultimately I have to go to somebody bigger than me in order for me to be safe, right? In order for me to be successful, in order for me to be happy and all these other things. And so basically what I'm getting at is, I think
that's some deep shit right there, yo. you just like, we could take that from how we do commerce to how the Black community operates in society. Like, I mean, that's a deep statement, but that's like the psychology behind that affects everything. I mean, it really does affect everything.
Yeah.
This peer-to-peer notion of transacting, you know, getting back to that psychology comment, it says that, well, I don't really know Jalen. I shouldn't trust Jalen. And to some extent, like, that's legit. But there are means of facilitating trust that don't require some big entity, right? And you know, going, you know, deeper into blockchain a little bit, like there's some properties of blockchain, and I'm not gonna like go through all of it here, right? Like blockchain is a disintermediating technology, right? It's a force to help us facilitate cutting out of middlemen, eliminating friction, you know, from the system and waste, right? Because basically somebody's taking that and putting it in their pocket, and all of us can live better with a higher quality of life if the services that we need on a regular basis aren't as expensive because we cut these middlemen out, right? That's basically eliminating friction from the system. But there are a few properties that make this possible, right? The blockchain itself helps to create a trustless network. And that doesn't mean that you can't trust the network. That means that no trust is required. It's like, you know, sometimes when I'm trying to like motivate people to do something that I want them to do, sometimes I'll tell them like, you know, don't trust me, right? You know, or I could show you, you know, better than I can tell you. Don't trust my words, right? Like, look at the actions, and you can trust that. And that's how the blockchain is. The blockchain is like, it could show you better than it could tell you, right? So you don't have to trust anybody on there. It's a globally distributed, and by globally distributed, what I mean is anybody can run the blockchain. You at home right now, you could go to Ethereum's website, download all the tools, and start running Ethereum on your computer. It gives you access to every single transaction that is basically executed on that platform. And you also have the ability to participate in what they call mining, but basically verifying that those transactions are legit by solving this mathematical puzzle on your computer that your computer knows how to do. And then, you know, if you solve that puzzle, then you get the right to write that on the blockchain. And again, I'll have, you know, more deeper pods to go into that. But because it's globally distributed, one person can't look behind, you know, keep it behind closed doors, tinker with it, right? And then say, hey, this is the result, right? Jalen has $1 million in his account, right? Because every other computer on the planet that's running this blockchain has to also say Jalen has $1 million. And if only Jalen's computer is saying Jalen has $1 million in his account, then all the other computers are going to call bullshit, right? And there's this thing that they call a consensus algorithm, right? And consensus is that everybody agrees, right? So all the computers around the globe have to agree that the data is the correct data. And as soon as Jalen goes and he tinkers with his shit behind the scenes, it's like, I got $1 million in my account. And everybody else calls bullshit. Like, well, you say you got $1 million in your account, but we all say you got $5, right? Because most of the computers say he only has $5. It's the $5 amount that actually gets written to the blockchain, not the $1 million that he was trying to write. And that's why you don't have to trust it, because the assumption is nobody trusts anything. And that's why you have to have that global consensus. And you know, it goes deeper than that, but yeah. But we'll get into that later. You know, the censorship resistant piece is huge, because, you know, like we were talking about with YouTube and Patreon, if somebody doesn't like your content on YouTube, YouTube can be like, all right, well, I'm just going to cut you off. Because the blockchain runs on not everybody's computer, but it's distributed globally on millions of computers. Nobody can cut it off. Like, you might be able to cut it off like in one city, but the rest of the world is still running it. You might be able to cut it off in the whole country, right? Like, China might just try to, you know, cut it off. It's still running in the rest of the world, right? And that data lives on. And so that censorship resistant piece, it allows for more freedom. So now, you know, you start talking about true democracy, right? Like, you know, this peer-to-peer interaction with all things. And this isn't just for financial stuff. It could be your healthcare records. You know what I mean? You know, it could be, you know, your consumption of electricity, right? Or if we wanted to ration electricity because we wanted to like stop global warming, I mean, it could be any number of things. But it takes the power out of a single individual and puts the power in the hands of the people. And that's, you know, that's kind of like, you know, what enables like, you know, sort of like this peer-to-peer interaction. But
you know what's funny about that, Walter? And my bad, man. I don't mean to cut you off, but like,
no, it's all good. It's a conversation.
But something you were saying just made something click for me, which is what's happening with blockchain and sort of like the financial system now. When you think about it, and I guess it goes beyond the financial system, but what's happening with blockchain is not totally different than what I think we saw happen with the internet back at, you know, at the dawn of the, you know, the 2000s.
You're absolutely right.
You know, man. And so just to imagine, like, to have almost like a second, revolution is not the right word, right? But this second sort of paradigm
shift.
And the second paradigm shift.
Yeah.
That is at the same magnitude of the internet itself. Like,
well, the crazy shit is people thought that we wouldn't see this twice in our lifetime. But because technology is accelerating things, right? We've got this like sort of elliptical curve. We're actually seeing it for the second time in our life. What a lot of people don't know, I'm gonna take you through a little bit of history right now. You know, my Block Boys crew. There's this notion of a general purpose technology. They call it a GPT. And these GPTs, they're paradigm shifting. Right. And so way back in the day, right, I think one of the first GPTs was when man discovered fire. That changed every fucking thing. Right. Now we can cook our food. Now we can, like, you know, scare larger animals that would prey upon us because we can control fire. We can heat ourselves in the wintertime. Right. It was paradigm shifting. That was the hot technology. And there were more in between. I'm going to skip a lot of them. The invention of the wheel. That was general purpose technology. It changed the game. Now we can carry loads farther distances than we ever could before, right? We can create, vehicles that we can pull, all kinds of stuff. There's all kinds of inventions that never would have been possible were it not for the invention of the wheel or the creation of the wheel, right? Fast forward to electricity, the ability to harness electricity. Now we can power entire cities. Like, it changed the game. Electricity, our cars, I skip past the combustion engine, but, airplanes, we can live in places that we wouldn't be able to live. We can do all kinds of things that we could not do prior to harnessing electricity, right? And then the internet, right? When the internet was invented, prior to the internet being invented, something like an Amazon.com was impossible to even conceive. And now, in the midst of a pandemic, we can all stay in our houses and have brown boxes delivered to our doors and get all of the the necessities that we need to live without even leaving our homes, right? Like it wasn't even possible, right? And so that dot-com era where it was like, you know, everybody was like this dot-com, that dot-com, and you know, a lot of us remember the dot-com bubble and the burst. It's probably going to happen with blockchain because blockchain is the next general purpose technology. It is changing the game. There are things that people are doing right now that weren't even being conceived of before because of blockchain. And some of it's bubble shit, right? And it's going to bust, right? And then part of what I'm trying to do with this channel is to expose some of these bubbles so you don't get caught. You know, I call it musical chairs. When the music stops, you don't want to get caught without the chair, right?
Right.
So be able to identify the bubble shit so that you can stay away from it. And leverage it, you know, to achieve maximum value the way a lot of people did with the dot-com internet shit. But, you know, I think, you know, to give us some last thoughts, Jalen, you know, on this whole, you know, set of topics we've been talking about.
Yeah, man. Like, you know, the thing that's I guess sitting on my mind right now is something you sort of alluded to earlier, which is, and this is all bringing it back to sort of this idea of cutting out the middleman. The one thing that you can always count on in any context when you're trying to cut out the middleman is that the middleman is not just going to let you cut him out, right? Yeah. And typically the middleman is the bigger, stronger entity, right? Like in this case, we're talking about like the American financial system, right? Or maybe even the American government in some respects.
Central banks.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, matter of fact, not to cut you off, but Pete Janet Yellen and how she talks about Bitcoin right now, right? And you know, she was the former
Fed chair.
Fed chair.
So it's like the thing that I would sort of use as my call to action, I guess, for the viewers, if you will, you know, if this is something that resonates with you, like this idea of disintermediation, this idea of cutting out the middleman, you know, and you want to think about, well, what can you do to get involved, or what should you do? Like, keep in mind again that while every day there are people like Walter, people like myself, people like whomever, who are actively working to push us into the future, right? There are just as many people who are doing everything they can to suppress that future, right? And I would also say, like, to make it a little bit more relevant, like to your individual life, is understand that these centralized entities, these centralized, you know, groups, when they feel threatened, when they feel their power is threatened, they become more aggressive, right? So it gets to the point where it's not just us, like, meaning, I guess you would say, like, people who are a part of the cause that are going to become targets, right? Like, they're going to start taxing even heavier, right?
Yeah.
So whether you want to join the fight or not, you know, you're going to continue to see greater pressure, greater downward pressure, you know, from your centralized governments and your centralized entities. And so I would say, man, it's like, yeah, just think about what the world could be if we were disintermediated, and think about what the world will be if we don't disintermediate soon.
Yeah, no, those are powerful words, and I think an excellent point to end on. Jalen, man, I appreciate you hanging out with me today, man. I'm happy to have you back. This was a good conversation. I think people are going to enjoy it.
Anytime I could pull up on the block, man. You know?
Yeah, that's what's up. That's what's up. All right. Well, next time, viewers, I'll holler at y'all. We'll be back.